From the New York City area, welcome to the Badass Counseling Show, where the master badass himself, Sven Erlandsson, takes you deep and gives balm for the soul, baby.
Hello, fine people. It's great to have you here on the Badass Counseling Show. You are in a live taping of this Badass Counseling Show. We have people checking in right now from around the world. We've been checking in before we started the music from as far away as the UK. We've got New South Wales. We've got the Western Slope, Colorado. Folks, we've got Phoenix up there in Montana. We've got folks everywhere, South Africa, and it's great to have everyone here. We have our own little family, our own little community of badasses. Badasses becoming, and you know, I'll work on it, right? Trying to fill ourselves out and become the fullest version of ourselves by getting rid of all that crud from our past. I'm joined in studio by KC, the lovely human being who joined us in the actual studio and talking earlier this morning on one of the episodes we taped with a veteran of the U.S. Marine Corps. And I'm also joined by Rob, the Rocket. Rob, what say ye?
By your command, ready to go. Whatever you'd like, my friend, I'm just here for you.
Well, you know, I tell you what, Rob always has some of the best wisdom, and so I hope we can engage some of that today. I'm starting out with this. You always say to write a letter, but don't send it. Why not send that shit? All right, I do ask that. I do tell people that if the goal is to heal you, the goal is to flush out all of the pain, the fears, and the bullshit beliefs you were taught about yourself. If the goal is to let go of a past lover, if the goal is to get over a divorce or your alienation from your best friend or from a sibling, what you have to do is you have to get all of the feelings out, all of them, especially the most intense ones, like rage or extraordinary betrayal, whatever it is. You got to get it out. Well, how do you get it out? You've heard me say it a million times, start journaling, go to your therapist, talk it out with your other best friend, or especially writing letters to the person that you do not send. You always hear me say that, but don't send it. Now, bottom line is, if you want to send it, you're going to send it, no matter what this idiot says, right? The reason I say don't send it, though, is this. Twofold. One, I was the guy that sent all those letters. My first marriage, and my wife divorced me, and we had kids and all that. And I was in pain for like two and a half years, right? And just journaling my ass off and flushing everything out. And, you know, we had kids, and so breaking up the family, and, you know, childhood shit was coming up as well. And I would send those letters, and after the fact, and it didn't change her. You know, I was trying to get her back and making stupid promises but it didn't change her and it didn't get her back. And in the end, some of them actually got used against me. Yeah, I felt like an idiot. Now, there's nothing wrong with feeling like an idiot. And in fact, it's that willingness to look foolish in life that enables us to take risks and so on and so forth. And I took those risks and so forth. But here's the real reason. Apart from, you know, you might be embarrassed by those letters later if the relationship doesn't work, but who gives a shit about that? Can't live in fear of being embarrassed. I mean, you're going to live a small life. The bigger issue is this. If you're writing a letter that you know you're going to give to someone, guess what you're going to do to that letter? You're going to edit it. You're going to say, well, I can't really say that because she won't want to hear that. Or man, if I ever said that to my dad, he'd kill me. You know, if I write this in this letter, he'll rage. Or, you know, that might hurt her feelings. And I'm just going to say it in nicer language. And I'm going to sort of tap dance around this. And you know what? I'm going to leave a few parts out. No. Editing, redacting, leaving stuff out, you know, soft shoeing, all that crap does not help your healing. The goal is to flush it out in the most powerful terms possible. When I have someone in counseling and I give them their homework, and all of my clients always get homework, and I give them the homework of write a letter to X, Y, or Z, whoever it is, Paul. Write this letter to Paul, and I say two caveats. One, you can't give it to him today or ever. Two, I want you to use the strongest, most vile, powerful, disgusting, nasty, swearing-filled language possible. And they're like, why? And I said, because I don't want there to be anything left in that pan that you're trying to scour, the pan that is your soul. I want you to get in there with a Brillo pad and the SOS and the fucking scrub brush and the steel wool. And I want you to scrub all the crud out of your soul. And very often the most encrusted stuff is the stuff that we've always pulled back on. I had a client just this week and she wrote a letter. I had her writing a letter to her, I think it was her mother. And she reads it back to me and she used like four swear words. And this is a very, very, very religious woman. And she was, I've never heard her swear in session. And she used four swear words. She gave herself permission. She said, Sven, I don't, this is what she said. Sven, I don't usually use naughty words. Okay, I've got a grown woman, 40-year-old woman saying naughty words. You know, it's like in America, you usually don't use the word naughty if you're an adult. That's a word you use with children, right? And so she referred to herself, those are naughty words. So that's how seriously she takes it. But she did it. And I said, how do you feel at the end? She says, I feel relief. I feel lighter. Exactly. So the more you allow yourself to get out all the feelings and all the rage and not soft shoe it and tap dance around that shit, the greater the effect. That's why we don't send the letters. Rob?
All right, here we go. Should I romantically pursue someone who is severely depressed? He says he likes me, but then goes silent for days. He has left me so confused.
The issue isn't whether or not he's severely depressed, really. That's not the issue. You can have a wonderful relationship with someone who has, you know, dealing with emotional issues or mental issues or someone who has any sort of issues. I mean, hell, we all have issues, right? But severe depression, can you have a relationship with someone who is severely depressed? Sure you can. Sure you can. But that's not really the issue. The issue is, how does the relationship feel? Regardless of whatever the medical diagnosis or the emotional whatever capacities or whatever of the other person are, the bottom line is, how does it feel to you? And you're saying, I reach out and the person doesn't get back to me for days. Well, you wouldn't even bring that up unless that felt like crap for you. I don't like how that feels. I want somebody who's investing back in me, who's there, who's present. Okay. And so whether it's the result of the depression or just the result of, he doesn't like using text, or the result of, you know, he's working a lot, or the result of, he gets nervous talking to people. It could be a result of a million things, but in the end, I don't like how it feels. I had a client who had come out of a divorce and she had started dating. And when we first started working together at the beginning of her divorce, you know, I told her, trust me, particularly with the work you're doing, but just who you are, your character, you're going to have men beating down the door. You're going to have a greater problem. And that is finding the right ones and making decisions, the ones that suit you. And she didn't believe it at the beginning. She's like, she just thought she was so worthless and wouldn't be loved again. She's, you know, 40 years old and I'm too old. And I'm like, oh, you have no idea. You talk to my 60-year-old clients, my 70-year-old clients, what age of their life they'd like to go back to. And very often, not always very often, it's 35 to 45. All right. But that's not the point. The point is this. So then she starts dating and she meets this one guy and hits it off. And, you know, before long, they decide to have sex and sex is incredible. And, you know, and he's the type of guy she likes and so on and so forth. And every time she would text him, he'd text back. And, you know, he was single and he proved it to her and all that and introduced him to the kids or her to the kids once accidentally because they bumped into each other at the grocery store, whatever it was. And she said, but Sven, when we do our walk and talk counseling sessions, she said, Sven, but he never initiates texts. He never initiates. He'll always respond right away, even if he's at work. And I know he's into me, but he never initiates texts. And I said, well, let's just keep an eye on that. Let's just keep an eye on that. And sure enough, another week, another 2 weeks, whatever it was, go by, and he's not initiating. He'll always respond, and he's always there and eager to do stuff with her and stuff, but he doesn't initiate texts. And she realized, I just want somebody who's thinking about me and initiating texts or initiating a phone call. I don't want someone who's just responding to me. I want somebody who is active. I said, for you personally, is that reason enough to let this person go and move on to the next one? For you personally, it doesn't matter what your best friend says. It doesn't matter what I say, but your mama says, what do you feel? She says, yeah, it actually is. I want somebody who initiates it. I said, then let it go. That's okay. And so that's what this is about, is that we're giving ourselves permission. What the hell was the original question? Go ahead, Rob.
Yeah, it was, should I romantically pursue someone who is severely depressed? Okay. He says he likes me, then he goes silent for days. Okay. I'm confused.
Right, okay, so this is what we're talking about. In other words, for this client of mine, who it just didn't feel good that this guy wasn't initiating, and that was important to her. Other people might laugh at that or say that's stupid or that's not important, but it is for her. We're all different. And so if you're in a relationship with someone who is severely depressed and it doesn't feel good to me, you have every right to move on. In fact, why would you stay in a relationship where your needs and wants aren't being met? Right? Unless you fear that you'll never have that. And then we cling and we hold on to something that's shitty and we end up getting more and more miserable over time. And this is why it's so important to do the work of flushing out all your pain. Why? So that I can feel what's really going on with me, what my body is saying, what my intuition is saying. This doesn't feel good, and that I can honor it. All right, next question. Why is it that the more you flush this stuff out, Sven, the more the demons keep coming back? It's like I tell people, one of the effects of, I was just saying this on a previous taping we were doing today, one of the effects of doing the work of purging out all your pain and your fears and your anger and your sadness and all these feelings, as well as those core beliefs from way back there, naming, finding those core beliefs, the origins and so forth. One of the effects is you begin to feel lighter. You begin to have spontaneous energy more and more. The more you do this work of getting all this crap out, you just literally have more physical energy. You literally feel lighter. You literally have greater clarity when it comes to your life and problem solving and so forth. But what always precedes that, the lightness, so in other words, one way of knowing that you're on the right path in your healing is you feel lighter. Another way is you feel you have more energy. You feel you have greater clarity. Those are ways of knowing that the work is getting done. Another way of knowing that you are on the right path is life all of a sudden starts feeling much heavier. Or your fear radically increases as you're pulling up this stuff, or it keeps coming back. This is a good sign. That heaviness is a good sign. Why? Because it says you're at the heart of the issue. Or near the heart of the issue, that you're actually going into the problem rather than running away from it. All right? So if you've got, why is it the more you flush out the demons, they keep coming back? Because you haven't flushed out the demons yet. And if it keeps happening, there's something deeper. If you're doing the work and you're having a repeat of something that keeps coming back, memory, pain, whatever it might be, it's because there's something deeper. There's something you're missing. Origins of that. And one of the things you can be doing in your journaling work is, what's going on inside of me now? Why? Or this particular demon is coming up. Why is it coming up now? And a very operative question. This is a really granular question. You're in your journaling, little tip that I teach. And I put it in Badass Wisdom. I might have put it in There's a Hole in My Love Cup, but you write enough books and time passes and you get old and you start to forget some of the things you put in. One of the most functional questions you can use in your own personal journaling is not just why. Why is the grandmaster of questions, because it takes you deeper into the problem. But the really very often pivotal question that I get the most mileage out of when counseling people and trying to find the origins of things is the question when. Somebody says, well, you know, my husband and I are getting a divorce. We separated a year ago. And I'll say, when did the marriage start falling apart? I don't know, Sven, 5 years ago? And I'll say, really, 5 years ago? And I'll push back and I'll say, are you sure? Might it have been a little sooner? And they'll say, well, okay, seven. We've been married 20 years. It started getting really bad about 7 years ago, to which I will respond, why seven? Why not 2 years ago? Why not 14 years ago? Why seven? What the hell was going on then? Why seven? Okay, so I led with a when, and then I went to a why then. Oh, now you're finding a trigger. And I don't mean, oh, things trigger me. I mean, you're finding the sort of the spark, the impetus, the initial something, and something happened then. Oh, I was feeling weighed down with work, and I started working with more, da-da-da, and she started getting distant, okay. Now we can go into that. So if you got demons that aren't being fully slayed, go into whens. Go into why thens. Go into what else might the problem be, or even ask yourself, your brain's like a computer sometimes. Ask it a question and then play with it. Let yourself play with the answers. So one of the questions I often ask myself in my journaling and my own counseling of myself is, what is it in this equation that I'm not missing? Or excuse me, that I might be missing? Now, I can do blind spots on myself, but most people hire me to be the one who helps them identify their blind spots, as we're doing literally right this second. But, why then is a big one. The other thing is, what am I missing? And what's my bias in this situation? But the other granddaddy of all questions, when you're trying to heal yourself and in your own self-work and journaling, and even if you're seeing a therapist or you are a therapist, the granddaddy of all questions is, what's the fear in all of this? And to which a lot of people respond, oh, I don't have any fear. No, there are no fears. I was counseling a young woman about, I don't know, 26, 27, going through some significant career change stuff, relationship stuff. And they were all sort of linked together. And I won't go into the specifics, but I said to her, so what are your fears in all of this? She paused. She thought about it. And I don't have any fears in this. I giggled politely, kindly. I said, zero chance of that. You wouldn't have anxiety over this decision. You wouldn't be struggling with it unless there were fears causing you to not know your path. And there are always fears. And the way to really get to the root of a problem is to determine what the real fears are, the deepest fears. What are they and why? And where the hell did that come from? That's how you slay the demons that don't just seem to go away. All right, next question. Moving on. Here we go. Go ahead, Rob.
All right, I'm trying to see both sides of this. I'm not sure I can. Mm-hmm. After 5 months of no contact with my ex, an extreme taker, he sends me a video song that he knows is connected to my son who has passed. Are those kinds of people really monsters like that? I reacted badly.
Okay, first of all, I'm sorry that your son has passed. Truly. You don't say how old your son was before passing, but it doesn't matter. I'm sorry for the loss of your son. I mean, that can really be interpreted two ways without knowing the character of the person, without knowing the character of the relationship that the two of you had. In an intimate relationship, even an intimate friendship, I have my good friend Lisa Louise. Occasionally she'll send me a song, a touching song or something, and that really touched her that day. I mean, we've all done that, right? You're listening to a song on Spotify and it's like, oh, I'm going to send this to my brother John, you know, or whatever, or to your girlfriend. We've all done that. In the context of a relationship where there's conversation around it, sending and where there is a relationship, there is sending something like that makes sense. Totally out of the blue, if I got a video with a song from an old girlfriend, let's say I got a video out of the blue from Serena and it's to some, you know, like love song. And I'm like, okay, that's fucking weird. Serena, terrific woman and all that, but a little weird because I haven't talked to her in about 10 years, right? 20 years, whatever. No, 12, 14 years, whatever. That's weird. And, you know, you don't reach out to somebody unless you're having thoughts of them and you're trying to reconnect. Or in this case, the other potential is the guy's trying to hurt you, trying to do damage, trying to fuck with you. Very possible. Your brain wouldn't have gone there unless you interpreted it. You felt it as that. So even without any context around it, without any relationship around it presently, any video or song, any reach out is going to be fucking weird. But this is of a whole different strata. You send it about my deceased son without any conversation around it? What the fuck? I don't care what your intent is. This is the deepest wound likely of your life. And this guy's sending out a fucking video. I don't care if it even was with good intent.
She says it was horrible.
Of course it was. And I am so sorry that even if there was good intent, at least put it in the context of conversation. At least put a paragraph in front of it that says, listen, I know I don't mean to offend in any way and so on and so forth, but I heard this and it made me think of your beautiful son. I just want to tell you, we may be done, but I feel sorry for the pain you've experienced. And I just want to send you this. It made me think of how wonderful your son was. And it says some things. If you don't want to listen to it, you don't have to. But sending warmth and condolences to you, that sort of thing. Put some words with it at the very least. But don't do. But general rule, don't do that shit with the death of someone, especially their child. Don't. And I mean, it's such a rare occurrence that it sticks out like a sore thumb, right? I mean, it's just this guy's. It, good thing you guys broke up. All right. All right, next question. How do I speak to my father? Okay. I guess he noticed after a while that I was in an abusive relationship. I think you mean to say that I was in an abusive relationship. He saw me in a cast when I had my elbow dislocated. He saw when I got my eardrum ruptured, well, me recovering, and he tried to take me to the doctor when I had a knife that was in my foot. I never told him that I was in an abusive relationship, but I thought that I could tell a person in my family. And doesn't take much use of the imagination to see a knife in a foot and to think probably coming from some relationship, right? But I thought I could tell a person in my family. Turns out that person leaked and said things, and my father, who was also abusive to me and reminds me a lot of my ex, wants to sit down and talk. All right, so just catch us all up here. The dad sees all this stuff. You told someone in the family. That person told dad. Now dad wants to sit down and talk about your abusive relationship. Okay, this is longer. I had to click more to the story. Well, I got you guys into it. So now we got to go through it. Now this makes me want to run away when dad wants to talk about it. I don't want to talk to him. I don't want to tell him my dad says I'm too skinny. What the fuck does that have to do with anything? I mean, why is dad saying that is what I mean by that. He wishes I looked the way I did before, and to be quite honest, when I was younger and I lived with him, I had bulimic tendencies because my father has some of the personality traits of my ex, and he beat me when I was younger. I'm a single mom, work two jobs. I'm under a lot of stress. My son has special needs, and I feel like, you know, that kid that just wants to please. I'm afraid of gaining weight. I'm afraid to talk to my dad because of his judgment. Am I afraid that he's going to put his hands on me? No. But I don't want to hear it. I don't want to cry. I don't want to get angry. Why am I afraid? How do I talk to him? I guess the question I would want to ask is, why do you want to talk to your father? The truth is, if you really wanted to talk to your father and you felt safe, you would have talked to him initially, not talked to a family member who happened to tell your father. Why do you want to talk to your father? And very often what the answer to that question is, and it may not be in your case, okay, but very often the question is, why do you want to talk to the parent, or why do you want to have a relationship with the parent? And so my question would be, is it because you want some kind of, you actually want a good relationship? It's always been shit and he was abusive and so forth. Do you actually want a relationship with your father? And very often when people really think about it, it's like, yes, I do. That they'll hold on and hold on. I've had clients who will hold on 20, 30, 40, 50 years holding on to that parent, even though the parent's an asshole or neglects them or doesn't take them seriously or uses them or what have you. They'll hold on. Why? And even after they die. I've had clients in their 50s, 60s, 70s. Even after the parent is long dead, they're still holding on. They're still living their life trying to win the approval of the dead parent. All right? Because if I got that relationship, I'm willing to bet that part of the reason you want that relationship, probably the reason you want that relationship with your father, you want to talk to him is because you want a relationship. Because then if you got the relationship, then you'd feel love. You'd feel loved. And then if you finally felt loved, you would feel supported. You'd feel accepted, appreciated. You would finally feel whole. You would finally feel healed. That the very pain that dad caused by his judgment, by his criticisms, by his abuse, the very self-hate that was created from all of those actions would finally be healed and you could finally be free and have relief and come alive. I literally, did I post the video? No, it's in the queue. It's going up today on this exact topic. That we want that relationship so that I can heal. So we hold on to someone who's an abuser parent. We hold on to the parent who is bad to us or is always or is using us or whatever it might be, hoping to get that relationship so that I can heal. And the fallacy in all of that is that I need something from them in order for me to heal. And that's our way back in childhood. A child believes that I still need that approval in order for me to finally feel like I have a sense of worth. And so what that does is it gives all the power to the parent. The parent, anytime someone has something that you want, they have the power to make you miserable by withholding it, okay? And that's what your father's doing. He can stand in judgment and criticize. Why? Because you keep wanting him, so you keep going back to him, hoping he'll change. But let's say your dad is 6 years old. Let's say you're 35 years old, okay? You have a 35-year pattern of behavior indicating he has no interest in changing. So it's kind of an ugly metaphor or visual, but it's like you're holding on to someone's collar and they keep punching you in the face. And you keep holding on because you're saying, just be nice to me, just be nice to me. You're hoping that some combination of words and actions will make them stop punching you in the face, but they keep punching you in the face because you're terrified to let go. Why are you terrified to let go? Because that means I will never get those needs met, which means I will never feel healed and whole inside. But you don't need anything from them in order to heal and feel whole. That's what all my tools are for. All right, more to come. But right now, let's take a quick break. I'll be right back.
I've been doing some real healing work in my life, and I mean hardcore. But I've been craving something new to level up. A friend of mine told me about this badass counselor. I gotta admit, I rolled my eyes. Then I watched a few of his videos, and yes, this is the guy. I went and got his audiobook, Badass Wisdom. Holy shit. Absolute ass-kicking, inspiring, deep, powerful shit, period. If you don't get this book, you're making a huge mistake. So do you got the guts to go big with your self-care? Go to badasscounseling.com, get the book Badass Wisdom now.
This show provides soul counseling intended to entertain and inform and is not medical advice. Now, back to the badass.
Hi, guys. It's good to have you back. This is a taping of the Lightning Round. Q&A of the Badass Counseling Show for those of you that are live with us right now. For those of you that are listening to the podcast long from now after it has finally posted. Not long, but you know what I mean.
February 18th.
February 18th. Great to have you here. All right. I've got a question here. A couple of quick questions here that I like that I want to hammer out. Once you start healing, you realize you've surrounded yourself by the same type of people. Why? I'm going to read that as that you realize you've surrounded yourself with the same type of people as your past, or the people, you don't really say what you're healing from, but yeah, I'm going to play it this way. Once you start healing, you realize you've surrounded yourself by the same type of people. Why? And you don't say, why do I realize it? Or why am I still surrounded by the same type of people? But it's implicit. Why do I surround it? Basically what you realize as you heal, you become aware. The Buddhists like to talk about awareness. I'm not Buddhist, but I like to steal from any place. There are good sources. All right. Awareness. That's what healing does. In large part, it makes you more aware of what's really going on around me and what's really going on inside of me. And see, now the genie's out of the bottle. Once I'm aware of how this relationship feels, I'm aware it doesn't feel good. Or I become aware, wow, Denise really doesn't care about my feelings. She likes it when I'm giving her all the attention. She'll talk for an hour. She'll interrupt me, but she doesn't really take time for me. Wow, how did I never see that before? We become aware of what's going on around us. We become aware of what's going on inside us. And then the big decision point comes. What do I do now? Do I stand up for my feelings and say, this is what I need, this is what I want? Or do I just walk away? Or do I just go back into the shell that I've been in and keep meeting their needs? But you can't do the healing work and stay in relationships. It's not even can't, you won't do the healing work and stay in relationships that stifle you and your importance and your authenticity, right? So maybe you'll stand up, make your needs met, and you'll see who they are. And you'll see how much they mean to you. Either they'll say, fuck, you're right. You know what? I do want to provide for you. I'm sure it was uncomfortable to say, but yeah, we need this for our relationship. And it's like, well, thank you. You just showed me who you are. Okay. Or the person will say, I don't know what you're talking about. Or they'll ghost you or whatever. It's like, thanks. You just showed me who you are. You showed me you really don't care. And it's hard to cut those relationships free, but that's what you got to do. And then what happens? So you start to lose people. You start to walk away from people, but then you begin to attract people who love who you've become. And that's a beautiful thing because now you've got an infinitely deeper and more fulfilling relationship. Next question is this from Betsy. Is it important to uncover suppressed childhood trauma with 5? Is it important to uncover suppressed childhood trauma? There are a few schools of thought on this, all right? Different strains of psychology have different opinions on this. I am not a psychologist, okay? So I'm going to speak from my experience 30 years as a soul counselor, level one emergency room chaplain at a level 1 trauma center, former pastor, counseling practice for 30 years. I'm just going to speak from my experience. And it's simply this, yes, that I am always taking my clients into that trauma from childhood, absolutely. Now, can other people do it without it? I have no idea, quite frankly. And I don't really care. I do it the way that I know I can do it. And I know what brings the healing. And I have had clients with every single type of abuse, trauma, childhood, war, murder, death, everything. And yes, the worst of the worst in childhood. The worst of the worst. Over 30 years, the worst of the worst. And every time they have the courage to go into it and take my hand and hold my hand and let me lead them into that cave that they fear to enter. Takes time. Doesn't have to take forever, though. In fact, healing can come far quicker than you would guess. Genuine, deep healing and removal of the trauma. Yes. So do I believe in it? Yes. But. What's the caveat in there? You got to have somebody who knows what the fuck they're doing, whose hand you trust to hold, who has the ability, who has the experience, who is a vessel large enough to contain the pain that is going to come out. Because they can't be someone who's going to be easily intimidated or walk away or lead you halfway in and say, oh shit, I don't know what I'm doing. Right? But can it be done? Absolutely. Do I believe personally that it's necessary for healing? Absolutely. You can learn to cope with life without going into that, but actual healing where you come alive again, truly come alive? Yeah. Anyway, next question. Rob?
Yeah, under the category of helping people to release the pain, there are a lot of challenging situations out there. Here's one from Colin. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with the pain from the betrayal of being told you are the father of a child and then find out you didn't father the child? The kid is now 2.5. I just feel numb.
Okay. Numb is an indicator, first of all, that you got a lot of feelings in you and it's overwhelming you. Okay. And given those circumstances, that makes total sense. I'm betting, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I'm betting, and you can tell me to go fuck myself or that I'm totally wrong. In a situation like that, you are told that a child is your own. The child's now 2 years old, and you discover it's not. They tell you it's not. The sense of betrayal, the sense of profound loss, I'm telling you what I would feel or what I believe would be normal responses to an extraordinarily abnormal set of circumstances. I would feel manipulated and angry as fuck. I would feel so fucking angry. I would feel so hurt that I was used. I would feel so hurt, above all else, that the person I thought was my son or my daughter is not my child. I mean, just, you're in shock. And you should be. That you are exactly where you need to be. This is what happens when something massively traumatic happens. It just blows you away. There was that poster from back in the 70s for Magnavox speakers. Remember that one, Rob? Long poster. It's like 3 feet long. It's black and white. And it's this guy sitting in this chair and he's got long hair.
As I recall, it's Maxell recording tape played through a big speaker.
It's so powerful, a speaker is blowing him back, blowing his hair back, right? That's what you're going through right now. It's just blowing you back. It's so powerful. If I were in your shoes, I would have so much fucking hatred for this shit, for the person who pulled this shit. I would have so much grief and sadness. Something died inside of you when you found that out. Whether you're aware of it or not, something died. And what died was what you believed to be a truth. Now, I don't know if this person is keeping you in their life. I don't know if you still get to be the father, even though it is not your blood child, whatever. I don't know the circumstances of that. But the bottom line is, and so you asked, what do? Journal about how you feel numb. Journal about numbness and what numbness feels like. Numbness is a feeling. It's like gray. It's the absence of color, or black or white. It's the absence of color, right? And that's what you're feeling right now. Journal about it. How does it feel? I hate it. Flush out all your emotions. Pick what. I guarantee there's one emotion that you think of when you think of this. Or one emotion that you feel. Which one is it? Sad, anger, hatred, disappointment, betrayal, frustration, melancholy. So journal about the sort of blown away, lost, in shock. Journal about that. Journal about any other feelings you're feeling. Journal about how that guy cut you off in traffic yesterday and it pissed you off. Journal about that. Write a letter to the person who pulled this one on you. Write a letter. Tap into a bit of that hatred. I'll bet it's there, or the sadness, whatever. But you just, the way you do it is you begin. And just so you're aware, I'm sorry this fucking happened to you. This is fucking heinous. That's some heinous shit. It was done willfully to deceive you with the life of a human being. That's hardcore fucked up, brutal. All right. Corbin asked the question over here on Facebook. How do I make friends? I'm always quiet and withdrawn. I'm tired of being alone. Thank you. You'd be surprised, Corbin, how many people struggle with this exact thing. How many people, and I love what you said when you said, I'm always quiet and withdrawn. I'm tired of being alone. And as you guys have heard me say a million times before, change will not occur until the pain gets bad enough. Your pain has clearly gotten bad enough. You're tired of being alone. Okay, what I would recommend to prep you for how to make friends and how to open up and how to not recede and how to not be quiet, you were conditioned to be quiet and withdrawn. And I'm willing to bet any money, if Vegas were giving me odds, that you got criticism growing up, or you grew up in a loud home, or walking on eggshells, or someone was always doing the talking and everyone else always had to do the listening. But for some reason, being withdrawn and quiet, while not bad things, nothing wrong with any of those things. I have times when I'm withdrawn and quiet. But to have that as a life motif is a learned behavior, and one that generally expresses fear. So you're living in fear that if you probably learned at some point in life that if you stick your head up, whoosh, you get cut right off. If you put something out there, it wasn't safe to put anything out there, a thought, an opinion, let alone your fucking feelings. It wasn't safe. So you've withdrawn. And a lot, oftentimes people who are withdrawn often are overthinkers too. Overthinking is another thing that you're always gaming out. Well, how might I get hurt? Well, if I say this, then they might that. And, or if I do this, well, they might leave me and so on and so forth. It's really the same thing. And being afraid to put yourself out there, my authentic self out there, even a little bit, is driven by fear. So what you need to do to prep, it's not you just dive in and change your behaviors to make friends. I don't believe in changing behaviors long-term. It won't change. Hear me on this. Trying to change behaviors doesn't change behaviors long-term. If you're just trying to change behavior, it won't stick. You have to change the core beliefs down here underneath them that are driving the behavior. How do we change the core beliefs? By identifying, first of all, what the core beliefs are. See, what's down there, what drove you, the conditioning. You were conditioned, in all likelihood, you were conditioned to be quiet and withdrawn. Again, by, it's almost always fear. So you go in your journaling, in your work with your therapist or your clergy person or whomever it might be, but you can do this shit on your own. You go into, where does this come from? Where do I remember first? When did I first go quiet? Dear friend of mine, you may have heard me tell this story before. She had, three kids, two sons and a daughter, and she'd always drive her daughter to school. Her daughter's an adult now, 36, whatever it is. But her daughter tells the story that, for like 20 years of my life, I was an introvert and I was quiet and I never spoke. Mom's like, it's crazy because you were so chatty as a kid. And the daughter finally said, yeah, Mom, because I remember you said to me, when we were driving to school, you said, quiet, Jenny, just quiet. I'm driving right now and traffic is stressing me out. Every time you drive me to school, not every time, but you get stressed out. And a lot of times you tell me to be quiet. And so I became introverted. I stopped talking. Parent, that was never the intent. Parent was just having a stressful drive to work. So the law of unintended consequences, right? Intentions and perceptions, right? And so in this particular case, you were conditioned to be quiet and it was fear. And so it's naming, what was I most afraid of? Who was I most afraid of? What were the messages I was getting from the powerful people in my life? I had a family this week reach out to me, and they're having problems with, five kids, and they're having problems with the younger son who has taken to lying and being greedy and so on and so forth. And parents are really stressed out over this and so on and so forth. And before I answered, man, because it's a regular client, I exchange emails sort of as, I don't charge for that. And so actually this morning I reached back to this person, this couple. But earlier in the week, before I gave the full answer today, I had asked them earlier in the week, I said, just real quick, because I'm in between sessions, I want you to send me an email of the distribution of power in your family. List every member, including yourselves, and then each of the kids. And what's the amount of power? What's the percentage of power that each person has? And they all have to add up to 100%. And, mom, 30%, dad, 30%, this kid, this much, this kid, that much, this. And then down at the bottom was little Jenny or whatever her name was, little Jenny. And I had to say to them, this person who has the greatest needs or has needs that you're struggling with, and she's lying or he's lying and he's doing all these things. This little Jenny or Jimmy, I forget if it was a boy or it was a boy. He's lying and doing these things because his needs aren't being met. His needs for attention and his needs to have his feelings heard and surrounded by love and acceptance aren't being met. And so he's engaging in lying. Why do children lie? Two reasons. One, to gain something good or to avoid something bad. What he's really trying to get isn't that toy he's lying about or that cookie he just stole and saying, I didn't steal it. No, what he's really trying to get deep down is attention. I said, but the problem is you have already just told me earlier in the week that he has the least amount of power. So isn't it interesting the person whose need is greatest right now has the least amount of power to get that need met? Right. Right. And so then, the response is, well, what, should we give him more power? No. It's that the people with the power have a responsibility for the people who don't have the power. They have a responsibility to tread gently. They have a responsibility to exercise their power to the benefit of the ones that don't have the power to look after. And this is why we talk about things like looking after the widow and the orphan and the outcast. That we with the power have a responsibility for those who don't have power, especially at the top of the list, the children. So anyway, just to finish that one with Corbin, you have to go into the origins and find those sources of the what caused you to go into that shell. The more you explore those, the more you're going to realize that who I was fine and I was a good person, but I was taught to basically distrust myself, distrust my own voice. And so then as you're going into those more, you're releasing that pain and that trauma, and the real you will begin to bubble up and you'll begin to take risks. Then you can risk conversationally and in relationships. Then you'll begin to take action steps. But action steps before going to the source of the problem won't stick. You've got to find the sources, and that will naturally loosen you up. You'll begin to open up more. All right, who have we got here? I've got one here from Priscilla, who asked the question here on Facebook. How do I tell my kids that dad has to go? I tell people, if you're considering ending a relationship, a divorce, a separation, something like that, or you think it might be coming at some point in the future, get your kids into counseling now, before the trauma happens, before you drop the bomb, okay? Don't do it after. It would be great. I mean, yes, after, do it if that's the only option. Preferably, you're doing it before you drop that bomb. Why? So that they already have a relationship with the person that they're going to need to lean on. Once that bomb drops, everything is shock, because the two people they love the most in the world are leaving each other. And that's a profound pain. Never underestimate the power of that pain on the child. Never underestimate the ability to recover as well. But nonetheless, get them in a relationship with a counselor. But so then you ask the question, how do I tell my kids that dad has to go? In other words, that you're ending the relationship. This is somewhat age sensitive. And in, let's just say, teenage and beyond, you sit down with them. I'm generally a fan of doing it together, but if you've got several kids spread over different age brackets, that gets a little bit trickier, but you do it gently. If the parents are getting along and can do it together, that's good, but you don't really mention that. You say, how can I do it? You go to your kids together, and you need to assume that a typhoon is going to hit your living room when you sit down with them and do that, okay? And you also need to assume every single one of your children is going to have a different response. And you need to become the best mom you have ever motherfucking been. It becomes about your kids far more than you're anticipating. You're going to have the child that doesn't respond. You're going to have the child that breaks out in tears. You're going to have the child that runs away into their room or runs outside, gets on their bike and flies away. You're going to be going in three different directions. And if you don't see that coming, you are naive. How do you say it? You say, I love you guys very much. And you know, your father loves you very much. But your father and I have discovered that as sad as it may be, we do need to end this relationship. And it has nothing to do with you. This is nothing that you've done to make this happen. Your father loves you very much. I love you very much. And so your father's going to be moving out. Now, it would be weird why the father's not in there. There's so many more questions here I want to ask. But you do it gently. You do it firmly. You have to remain open to the fact that every single one of your kids is going to respond differently. And more often than not, over time, the kid you need to be most worried about is always the one that seems to be handling it the best. That doesn't have all those feelings, that isn't showing them all, because that means they're locking that shit down. But there are just so many variables operating in this equation. But you do it kindly, you gently, you do it clearly. And if you and the father can do it together, you keep reassuring them of the love, and then you shut up and you let them express how they're feeling, and let them express how they're feeling every fucking day for the next X number of years, whatever it is, or however long it takes. You need to anticipate they're going to be behavioral problems at school. Anticipate that. Assume that's going to happen. And you have to begin, and this is why it's better to have the child in therapy ahead of time, so the child can begin to have language for what's going on inside of them. Because they're going to have feelings going on inside of them, and they need to have mechanisms for getting that out. That's what words are for. But if you've got a six-year-old child, what do you think the level of capacity is that they have to put words to what's going on inside of them? Or even, hell, a 16-year-old, let's say a 16-year-old boy who was always taught, you know, can't handle your feelings, or, you know, suppress that shit. Oh, yeah, now they're really going to have shit going on inside of them. You don't think they might start drinking? You don't think they might start getting sick of the very sport that they've always loved the most, i.e. that they might slide into a depression? All those things are going to happen. You need to be ready before you drop this bomb. You need to be on your game. You need to be sure that you're getting good sleep every night. You need to be sure that your boss is okay if you're working a bit less. Because if you think life's going to go on as normal for you when you've got three kids, let's just say, now with all of them having emotional needs, if you think life's going to go on as normal for you, no. And your pain, your shit, you got to deal with that so that you're able to be present to those children. Because this is where now it's make or break time. Let's keep going. What do we got? Rob, have you got one you want to share with us?
I do. Hi, Sven. Why do we self-sabotage? And how can we stop and take control of ourselves better?
You're self-sabotaging because there's stuff going on inside of you. And this is why when I talk about flushing out the pain and the fears and the bullshit beliefs that you were taught about yourself, that's why I always say the pain and the fears actually aren't the most important part. The most important part is those beliefs that you were taught about yourself that you can't even see right now. You can't even see them. And it's like, well, how do I flush out something that I can't even see? And that's what I created all these tools for, such as there's a hole in my love cup. All right. I created this to walk you through, to hold your hand through that process. Those core beliefs that you were taught about yourself, you're no good, you're not wanted, you're unlovable. Those core beliefs that you were taught about yourself are the virus infecting the operating system of who you are. It's those beliefs. And the book does this, but basically it gets down to identifying the things you were taught about yourself. That's where the self-sabotage is, that something is happening inside. It's like a computer. Why does a computer shut down? Why does it self-sabotage? Why? Because there's something happening in that fucking computer that I can't see. So I got to take it to the pros to have them get that virus out of there. The computer is shutting down or the computer keeps doing whatever. It's the same way with your system. If you continually self-sabotage, it's because you've got some core beliefs that you were taught about yourself that are working against you. So it's like, as you've heard me say before, you have one foot on the accelerator and one foot on the brake. And you're starting things, you're not finishing, you're undermining your own relationship, your fears are driving the equation. But all of that stuff is driven by stuff that you were taught about yourself and about life. Let's give one example. What's an example? One example that isn't necessarily even about you as a person, but it's an example about life that could affect a child. When my children were young, I was very deliberate about insisting with their mother and me. I said, when our children, we will not use the words, be careful. We will not use those words. Instead, we're going to use the words, take your time. Take your time. Go your speed. So when the kids are on the playground, if they're up on the monkey bars or whatever, we wouldn't say, oh, be careful. Why? Because I'm causing the child to pull back. Be careful means pull back. Be tentative. Be afraid of what might happen. Whereas take your time means trust your own instincts. Go your own speed. Right? So a parent continually saying, be careful, or similar messages like, the world's a scary place, or you can't trust anyone. Messages like that, even if it was the parent's self-talk that the child heard out loud or the crosstalk between the parents, all right, that child gets the message, the world is a scary place. What is a child imprinted with a message, the world is a scary place? What sorts of behaviors is that child and later adult unaware, what are they likely to engage in? Tentative behaviors, hesitation, potential overthinking. Looking out for all the fears in the world because the world's a scary place and I need to be careful. I had a client, I write about this in There's a Hole in My Love Cup. There's a chapter entitled, Are You Sure? And I had a client who was NCAA Division I collegiate athletic coach. And for the season, at the end of the season, he and I were counseling. I was counseling him and they were ranked number one in the season for most of the season. And they ended up losing in the national playoffs and not winning the national championship that everyone thought they would win. He ended up having such a great team that he had released more players of his had gotten drafted into the pros than any other team that year and any team he had ever had. And it was a masterful year, but they didn't win the national championship. And it all tracked back to one decision midway through the season where the most critical role on the field, he didn't put his old starter back in who had been injured for the first half of the season. He didn't put his old starter back in who had carried the team through three previous seasons building up to this season. He didn't put him in even though he believed that athlete was ready, didn't put him in because the position coach of that position said, no, the guy that we got in there now is on a roll. We got to keep him in. So he deferred to his position coach who had been the coach that had been with him the longest time. And the sequence of events subsequent to that, which I will not go into because it's just too much story, eventually cost them the national championship because when they did finally put that original starter back in, he didn't get enough repetitions between when they finally put him in and the national playoffs. And he made one or two mistakes in the national playoffs that he had never made before. And it was because he hadn't gotten the reps getting back into the role. And I said, so in that moment, you make 5,000 decisions, 50,000 decisions in a season based on your instincts. You're the top NCAA Division I coach in your sport. Hundreds of thousands of coaches in your sport at Division II, Division III, high school, pony leagues, peewee leagues, bantams, squirts, all whatever. They would come to you for advice. You are the best of the best that year. And in that decision, you didn't trust you. You trusted someone, and I'm sure you trust your coaches a lot, and you listen for their input. But in the end, if you have a difference of opinion, you go with your own instincts. That's why you're the head coach, right? He says, yeah, of course. I said, but this time you didn't. This time you didn't. He's like, holy shit. And I said, what? And I said, so you doubted yourself. You're basically in that situation. You're saying, well, gosh, maybe I should. You doubted yourself in that moment. And he said, holy shit. I said, what? He said, you know, Sven, I was just up skiing with my wife and my kids. You know, we went out to Colorado and we were skiing at Vail or whatever. And I called my mom and it was a Sunday night. And because I call my mom every Sunday night. And I, you know, at the time he was like in his, I don't know, early to mid 40s, I'm guessing. I don't recall. And he says, you know, mom, oh, what are you doing, honey? And he says, well, we're up at, you know, Vail or whatever, Aspen, we're skiing. And mom's response was, skiing at your age? Are you sure? He said, Sven, that's literally happened just, you know, not long ago. He said, that's it. That's it. She has been saying that phrase my entire life. Are you sure? And I said, so that's why you doubted it. You have been conditioned to doubt yourself. Now, that pattern of thinking is probably is part of what got you to the level that you're at. That you're constantly questioning, you're constantly digging deeper. Am I missing something? You're evaluating all of the analytical data. You're evaluating everything. It probably has helped your decision-making, but in this one case, it caused you to question your decision-making and not go with your own instincts. You went with someone else. And I said, if you trust your own instincts in all those other situations, why didn't you trust yourself in this one? And he said, honestly, Sven, because that position coach has been with me the longest, and I knew if I went against him or against his wishes on this one decision, that he would piss and moan and he'd whine and he'd be a bitch the rest of the season. I said, isn't that fascinating? Your fear of him being upset with you, but more importantly, your own doubt of yourself, are you sure, caused you to second guess yourself and it cost you a national championship. Is that what you're saying? He said, that's exactly what I'm saying. Okay. You still think childhood messages don't matter? And he had never seen it. And let me tell you, when he saw that, are you sure? You could see the light bulb go on above his head. You could see it. He said, that's it. And I reached over and I shook his hand and I said, congratulations. He said, on what? I said, today is the day you finally became the head coach of the blah, 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 blah team. I'm not going to tell you the school or the sport. Today is the day you finally became the head coach. Came at a hell of a price. That's the power of these childhood messages. Go and read that story. It's in There's a Hole in My Love Cup. Title is Are You Sure? Well, people, this has been lovely. What did Carol Burnett say at the end of the show? What was the song?
I'm glad we had this time together.
That's exactly right. This has been delightful. To have you here. So many great questions. As you know, my books are available, Badass Wisdom, and There's a Hole in My Love Cup at badasscounseling.com. The audiobook is only available there, not Audible or anywhere else. There are not nice authors over there. And there's a free PDF study guide that goes with it. You can download that there on the website so you don't have to keep rewinding the audiobook tape. And Rob.
Yo.
Let me check in with you. What are you thinking? What are you feeling?
I'm thinking your listeners, these people with the questions, really appreciate your passion because sometimes we don't recognize our own feelings or the depth of them, and you bring it right out and you really do help.
Well, thanks for saying so, and I hope that's true. I think every one of us is just trying to brighten the little corner where we are, right? I think so. Well, folks, thank you so much. You can catch all of our podcasts, last 180 episodes, whatever it is, on Spotify, Audible, Apple Podcasts, iHeart Music. It's the Badass Counseling Show. Thank you so much for tuning in. And on behalf of Casey and Rob, to everyone around the world, from South Africa to Dublin to New Zealand, have a kick-ass day.
The Badass Counseling Show is strictly copyrighted. No copies may be made without the express written consent of the Badass Counseling Show, LLC. The Badass Counseling Show is produced by Karen Camparelli and Robert H. Friedman. Executive producer, Sven Erlandson. Original music by two-time Emmy Award-winning composer, Trevor Morris. Have a kick-ass day.